Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Sports Central. I'm Neil Duncan. Hey, we got a great show lined up today. We're going to talk Safari Wilderness, and we're also going to talk about the Mid-Florida Football and Cheer Conference. Stick around, everybody, for this week's edition of Sports Central. Everybody, welcome back to Sports Central. Neil Duncan alongside Hank Longo.
And this first
segment brought to us by Contempo Vacation Homes, of course, a great partner of tourism and sports marketing. And it's that time of year. I know we've been talking about, I think, football season's about six games in, college football, and five or six games into the NFL season. So getting into that fall season.
Getting in the fall season, going to have a lot of folks coming down. That's where these vacation homes do so well because they house about 50% of our tourism.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, it's a great time of year. And our first segment, we're going to talk about one of those special events in the fall. But we are blessed to have great attractions here in Central Florida's Polk County. And one of them is Safari Wilderness. And we're glad to have Emily Jaffe here to talk to us about Safari Wilderness. And Emily, thanks for coming on Sports Central.
Thank you guys for having me. It's good to be here.
Well, let's first talk about if citizens or viewers at home don't know what Safari Wilderness is. Let's do a brief snapshot of what Safari Wilderness is and where it's at in Polk County.
Great. So Safari Wilderness Ranch, we're a 260-acre working game farm located in North Lakeland. So just off of Moore Road, for those of you who know where that is. And we're home to roughly 500 animals representing about 55 different species. We specialize in exotic hoofstock, so animals that most people are familiar with, like zebra, we have some camels, things like that. But we're also home to a lot of more rare and endangered critters that folks have never heard of, like the scimitar horned oryx, which are actually extinct in the wild. We also have Barasinga, Sitatunga, and other animals like that that are very unique and most.
What do they look like, these animals that you just described?
So scimitar horned oryx are beautiful animals. They're a white horse antelope. So they're mostly white, and their neck is a little bit tannish brown, and they have these beautiful big curved horns. That's actually how they got their name. Scimitar is the curved sword. And they actually think that this animal is where the myth of the unicorn came from, because when you look at them in profile, it looks like there's just one.
Wow, very cool. And then the others?
Yeah, the others, so, I mean, some of them are deer, so they have the antlers. We also have a lot of bovids, so horned animals. They're really, really unique and can really best be described by seeing them, and that's why we're really excited about getting folks out to take a look at some of these animals that they've never heard of, because our whole idea is we want to promote conservation, and it's really difficult to conserve a species that you've never heard of or never seen before. So that's where we come in.
How do you locate that type of species? I mean, if they're rare and extinct in areas, I mean, there's got to be just something special that you're able to find them and you know, bring them to the Safari Wilderness.
That's a great question. One of our owners, Lex Salisbury, he ran the Lowry Park Zoo in Tampa for over 20 years before starting this business. And we're also accredited by the ZAA, which is the Zoological Association of America. So through his history in the zoo world, and then also through our membership to this accrediting organization, we have lots of contacts within the zoo community, and we'll oftentimes, you know, trade or buy or sell with other accredited institutions. But the majority of the animals we have on our property were actually born there. The way that the park is set up, there are these big open pastures on 260 acres, and so the animals are really happy and in a non-stressful environment. So both of those things really lend themselves to lots of breeding. So we're always having lots of babies and new arrivals. We just had one of our Austrian Haflinger horses give birth to a little foal about a week ago. So
you talk about all these animals and the experience, and if you haven't been out there, it's absolutely fantastic. And you know, you look at Legoland, and they came in, and 2 to 12 being the target demographic for them. This is family friendly at its best. So a fantastic facility. But I have to talk about the lemurs, because that's probably, I don't know if you guys promoted it, but to me, that's the main attraction. Talk about the lemurs and what folks can experience if they interact with them.
Sure. So everyone who comes out goes on a safari. We have several different types. trips. You can go by vehicle, by camelback, by horseback, even by kayak. But we also have these really cool additional activities that folks are able to participate in, like our Feed the Ring-tailed Lemurs. And so that's an extra activity, but what we do is we take our guests into the lemur habitat, we give you a handful of grapes, and you actually get to feed the lemurs. They're very polite, as you may recall.
Yeah.
And their hands...
They're so gentle.
They're so gentle. Yeah. We always say, you know, we don't touch the lemurs, we don't try and pet them, they don't like that. But you'll definitely be touched by the lemurs. They'll gently grab your hand to pull it closer to get the grape, or they'll tap you on the leg if you're not giving them enough attention and giving all the grapes to their buddy. But their hands are so soft, and they feel like little newborn baby hands, and they even have little fingernails. Some of them are right-handed, some of them are left-handed. It's just a really unique experience to be able to interact with such cool animals.
Well, it's almost when you and I've had the opportunity of being there and interacting with them, and they're almost like little people.
Oh, exactly.
I mean, because of the way they interact with you, it's like, you know, we're just little people that are hanging out with you. And by the way, you know, come here and give me that grape. And it's probably one of the neatest, uniquest experiences that you'll have with an animal, because they're just so... for not knowing you, you know, for being a stranger, there's not that getting used to knowing
you. They're so curious. You know?
Yeah, and it's just fascinating.
And they're
really
very expressive with their facial features. They're just really cool animals. And, you know, the more senses you're able to engage in an experience, the more likely you're committing that to memory. So by being able to touch these animals and hear them and smell them, that's something that's going to stick with you for much longer than just walking past one at a exhibit at, you know, a zoo or something like that.
Well, when you talk about a zoo, and you had mentioned the friendly environment, it's different than a zoo. You mm-hmm. know, when you talk about all these animals, because you would go to this area to see this animal and this area to see the other animal, this is wide open.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot of concrete.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's wide open space, so that they're all just roaming around. Like if you went to Africa, you'd be out on a safari, you'd be in all this wide open space, and that is the same thing here, is the animals just wander all around. Although they'll stay in their groups,
right?
You know, but it's, you're not seeing them penned in an area to go see them. They're just all walking around. And like the big buffaloes, what are they?
The
water buffaloes to be, you know, on tour in the bus and have them walk up to you.
I think you should send Hank out for you guys. He's very excited. That's good.
It is to see these big animals come walking up to you.
Gentle giants, really.
It's fascinating.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're not down on traditional zoos at all. They do an amazing job of educating millions of people each year. But what's really cool about Safari Wilderness is because we have these big open pastures, we're able to house these animals. And the reason most folks have never heard of a lot of the species we house is because they require such huge areas and live in such large numbers that those zoos that are typically found in cities just don't have the space
to be able to provide for them. And then the other good thing, though, is how those animals have been preserved because of you, and that you've, you know, rescued them per se and have given them a new place to live.
Yeah, it's very important to keep the genetic diversity in captivity really, really diverse. We like having large gene pools to pull from so that when introduction programs with species like the scimitar horned oryx that we mentioned earlier, when they go to reintroduce them into protected parks in Africa, they have a lot of genetic diversity to pull from.
So you have the regular safaris that are going throughout the year, but let's talk about one of the reasons you're here is to talk about the pumpkin safaris, which are October 15th, 16th, 22nd, 23rd, 29th, and 30th. Did I get them right?
Yes. Okay. So Saturdays and Sundays in
and
October.
Okay. And that's when you go on a safari and you visit all the pumpkins walking around out there, isn't that?
Not quite. Close, but not
quite. Walking around. That's what I thought of pumpkin safari was.
Oh, goodness.
Boy, I was off on that one, I guess.
So what is a pumpkin safari?
So our pumpkin safari is kind of our fun fall-themed twist on our vehicle safari. Rather than being out on our custom safari vehicle for 2 hours, it's closer to 1 hour. But what we do is we have a focus on some of the other activities that we offer. So while you're out on the safari vehicle, you'll still have a chance to feed the water buffalo and see a good number of the animals. Uh-huh. But there's also a large focus on the smaller critters. For example, we had our first weekend of pumpkin safaris last weekend, and we were able to bring out one of our coatis on the harness and leash so folks could interact with them. And that's something that we don't typically offer during
What's
our normal safaris. They look a little bit like raccoons.
Okay.
They have long tails that are kind of ringed. Okay. They're really good with their hands, just like raccoons are. They're a little mischievous at times, but these ones are very sweet. And every admission to our pumpkin safari comes with a free pumpkin. So guests can either carve that or decorate that at our little craft stations that we have at our facility, or you can take it home. But the cool thing about it, if you leave it there for the animals, is we'll actually give the animal or give the animals the pumpkin. And you know, that's just something very new and exciting for them.
What animals like to eat pumpkin? All of them?
The pigs especially, our porcupines love the guts of the pumpkin. Wow. Our larger animals will play with them or get them stuck on a horn or something. But the lemurs, since you love the lemurs.
I do love the lemurs.
What we do is we'll, you know, carve a face out in the pumpkin and stick some grapes inside. And so that way the lemurs have to really think about, how am I going to get these grapes? And so they're reaching in the eye holes, or they're trying to take the top off. It's really fun to watch them play with these enrichment items.
Well, I'm sure you have a number of social media avenues or opportunities for folks to see it. So maybe they can't go this weekend, but they can see the activities. Talk to us about what social media, you know, what's the website, what's the Twitter, all that stuff.
So our website is safariwilderness.com. Mm-hmm. We're also on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. If you search Safari Wilderness, we'll pop up. And that's really one of the best ways to stay in touch with us is through our social media, especially Facebook. Uh-huh. And yeah, it's a lot of fun. We posted photos from the first weekend.
Camel rides when they come out there.
Yes, we'll have camel rides available for the pumpkin safaris. We were talking about
that
earlier.
And you know the best day to ride the camel.
Hump day.
On Wednesday is the best day to go ride that camel.
I feel like I lost control here. But
real quick,
regular safaris. Let's give a price on that, and then obviously there's special offers throughout the year.
Yes.
So there's a price, but then depending on the time of year, they're specials.
So our vehicle safari, which is our most popular, that one's going to be $75 per person, the normal price. And then our horseback safaris, camelback safaris, and kayak safaris are all $150 per person. Now, all of our tours are by reservation only, except for our pumpkin safaris. So if you have a ticket to our pumpkin safari, which is available on Groupon, you just come out on any Saturday or Sunday in October between 1 p.m. and 6 p.m., and we'll take care of you.
All right.
Now, this is just something that I just learned. You said you have kayak tours. Where do you go kayaking there?
We have several freshwater channels that go through the pastures, but the one that we've been using, you go through our first view pasture where we have water buck, red lechwe, llamas, things like that. And you kayak around and view the animals actually from the water.
Wow.
And then once you get tired of paddling, you get off on an island where a bunch of lemurs live. And so there's actually a lemur feeding included in our kayak safari experience.
Oh, that's very cool.
Just an experience that you can't. And recently voted one of the top safaris in the country. So, Emily, thank you so much. I know we could keep you on the whole show.
Yeah, we didn't even get to talk to you about North Carolina and your school and all that.
That's all right. You'll just have to have
me
back.
We'll have to have you back. But one more time, the website.
SafariWilderness.com.
Okay, and you can get a full listing of all the dates, not only for the pumpkin safaris, but hours of operation when they're open during the year. Again, Emily, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, upcoming we have the 2016 Hog Rally. That's the Harley Owners Group. It's an event recruited here to Polk County, and it's upcoming in the month of October. But we worked with PGTV right here as part of the Board of County Commissioners to put together a publicity video. We're going to take a look at that. Before they come into town, and Hank and Neil will be right back here on Sports Central.
honored to have you all come to our community. We're biker friendly. We're a safe, clean community. We have great restaurants. We have great neighborhoods. We have amenities. We invite you to come look at our community. I think you're going to love what you see. I promise you, you won't be disappointed.
I'd like to invite you to Polk County and to Lakeland for the Hog Rally. I think we'd have some great riding roads and destinations, twisty and hilly and scenic, and I think you would enjoy Polk County, the best place in the state.
We have a fantastic facility at Sun and Fun with unlimited camping, unlimited resources for riding, parking, get great food, great entertainment.
We're excited about you considering coming to Lakeland and Polk County for the fall conference here in Polk County. We'd love to have you. As a Harley rider myself and a Hog member for years, I have ridden the Blue Ridge Parkway, I have ridden the Black Hills of North Dakota, and I've ridden Yellowstone Park. We want you and your members to come ride the orange tree lined roads here in Polk County. Be safe, watch out for the other driver, and by all means, you know the motto, live to ride, ride to live. Welcome to Polk County.
Sports Central, Neil Duncan alongside Hank Longo, and this segment brought to us by Bright House Networks, great partner of tourism sports marketing. But you look at that video there, of course we want to thank PGTV and their crew, all the guys and gals that were out there, and Commissioner Lindsay, as well as the mayor of Lakeland, Mr. Wiggs, Mayor Wiggs.
Just surprised to see all these guys with bikes and cruising around.
Well, great, the economic fun trip. Yeah, on the economic impact to come to Polk County again, it's just an example of having that diversified portfolio of events. You know, you can only have so many baseball, you can only have so many softball or football, because you have to, you know, the sports that have grass, you have to let that grass rest during certain times of the year. So bringing in those events and maybe aren't burning that, up.
Burning up the turf. Yep, exactly.
Well, we're going to completely go against that and talk about an event that burns up the turf.
Football.
Just kidding. We're talking Mid-Florida Football and Cheer Conference and the president, James Hogan. He was here last year, back again, and welcome back to Sports Central.
I'm glad to be back. I appreciate you guys having us.
We know you don't burn up the grass.
No.
We know that.
No.
But you do have a number of events in Polk County with huge economic impact, and tell us a little bit about the Mid-Florida Football and Cheer Conference before we talk about the event you're here for.
Okay. First on Mid-Florida Football and Cheerleading Conference, we've been around since about 1999. We probably have about 40 different leagues, and those leagues are spread out throughout Polk County, but also Hillsborough, Orange, Okeechobee, Volusia. We're from one coast to the other as far as membership.
Wow.
We have a 10 game season where we break it down into 8 different districts, and they all play each other, but the culmination of that is our Super Bowl here, and also our Mid-Florida Football Cheerleading Cheer Off. Those events are what our kids work for throughout the whole season, and we're just getting into the
part of the year where they get to go to the Super Bowl. So when you say you have teams that are all over the, from one end of the state to the other, how do they get together to play? I mean, that's kind of some huge trips there. Do they play in their little region, and then the winners of those regions will go to the Super Bowl?
And that's pretty much how it happens. We try and keep them as close as possible to their particular district. But one of the things that, especially this year that happened, we had a lot of leagues that wanted to play some of the other leagues that were outside of their district.
That is playing the same team all the time.
Right. So we had teams from like Clearwater, for instance, that played teams in Orlando, and vice versa. We got teams in Okeechobee that played teams in the Clearwater or the St. Pete area, because they wanted that competition. We don't require that they go that far, but sometimes they like to do that.
Wow.
You've been involved in coaching and of course in this role is kind of facilitating with the league, but in all your years of being involved with youth football, how have you seen the game change? Because obviously with social media and with recruiting for, you know, not just Division I, but all the way through the ranks, the recruiting process and the ability for athletes to get their game footage, their film out there for coaches to see. How have you seen it start or change over the years at that age level?
It's really amazing. It's these kids are being put on showcases at early ages. You know, we're talking even our flag players, because everybody, you know, mom and dad is out there doing video. We actually have, you know, a lot of the leagues have professional people that come out and do video. And those things, of course, go on Facebook, go on different social media sites, and they share it between families. But you got things like Huddle. A lot of our leagues are involved with the Huddle situation. So the kids are seeing so much quicker now versus, you know, waiting to high school and that.
The good thing, and we've talked about this in Polk County, because Polk County is such a hotbed of talent, whether it be football, basketball, baseball, it doesn't really matter what sport it is. But the good thing about a high school athlete, it's not like college where they can leave early and go to the professional ranks. At least in high school, you get them all 4 years, which is great for to be able to further develop that talent, because all too often you see some kids make the jump into the professionals and they weren't ready. The good thing about this, even though they're discovered at an earlier age, they still have to develop.
Yes. And one of the things that goes on now that we are really concerned with, that we really promote good, proper techniques as far as the football is concerned. We're affiliated with USA Football, mm-hmm. and the heads up football style of playing. So our emphasis is make sure these kids are safe, and we want them to also be able to get positive images and positive memories of their time, you know, playing youth football and cheering.
So let's talk about the different age groups, because you say they start young. How young are, what's the first age group? And they're playing, I would suspect, flag football.
Right. Our first age group is from 4 to 6. And those kids play flag football, and it's girls and boys. And you would really be surprised at the talent that comes out in a lot of these kids, even at that younger age.
Sure.
I mean, some of these kids are fast, and they get football knowledge because of, you know, television, because of the games. They get a lot of football knowledge early, and they get out there and they show their wares.
Wow, that's fantastic. So you go from 4 to 6, and then what's the next group?
Our next group is 7 and 8 year olds, and that's the first tackle group. And then we actually have 9 and 10s. 11 and 12s, and 13 to 15.
And so the kids that are playing tackle, 13 to 15 years old, after that, is that when they start playing high school football?
Yes. The one thing is, you know, of course, they can't do both. Mm-hmm. We try and develop them as best we can so that they're prepared to make that next
transition
step. Because there's a big difference between playing youth football and then going into the high school arena. So we try and connect with our local high schools, the different leagues that are in the different cities. They try and connect with their local high schools to try and, you know, make sure their kids know how the next level is going to be. And we really, we've been pretty successful with it.
Well, that's
obviously
great.
A league like yours that encompasses a lot of areas in the state. I would think the training of the coaches, making sure that the coaches had training, because you talked about the heads up,
yes,
with the tackling and all that. I know when I coached it from peewee to high school or whatever it was, I would always tell my players, I'd rather you miss a tackle than leave in an ambulance.
And that's true. We really have to make sure, because we're being entrusted with these young people,
right,
you know, by their parents, and it's our job to make sure they're safe. And I may harp on USA Football a little bit, but they get it.
Mm-hmm.
They understand that, you know, in order for us to keep these kids involved in this sport, parents are going to have confidence that we're doing it the right way. And so, you know, our coaches go through a certification through USA Football, heads up tackling, just to make sure that they're following the correct fundamentals. Each time they make a play, are they going to be exact how we want? Probably not, but if we teach them enough, more than likely, you know, they're going to have
the... And it comes with repetition.
Yes.
The more you're out there, the more they're coached, the more they're going to be acclimated to the right technique for for playing the game. How did you get into coaching? Where does all your background come from?
Well, my background comes from, you know, I'm from Polk County. My first coaching stint was at Bartow Youth Football, and while coaching, I was on the board. And then I got into a little bit of the basketball coaching in Winter Haven. But as far as getting into Mid-Florida, I was asked by one of our founders, Harris West, to assist in forming another team that was in Winter Haven. And lo and behold, we got started, and next thing I knew, I was engulfed back into coaching football again. And it's been that way ever since then. My effort is to make, I want to see success. I want to see success with the kids, meaning that, you know, yes, they play football, but then they go to the next level in high school, and we've learned them something football-wise, but also some life lessons. You know, if we don't teach them life lessons, then, you know, it's going to be tough for them to be successful, and that's really what we try and do.
Yeah, one of the philosophies of Polk County Tourism and Sports Marketing for years is to bring the organizations or have the organizations in Polk County, and then they bring their marquee events into the county, obviously generating that economic impact that we're always talking about. The Super Bowl event, obviously having you guys located in Polk County, bringing that event in here. Let's talk about, when is the Super Bowl? How many teams are we talking about? So folks at home can really... Yeah, you start thinking about those dollars and that economic impact for Polk County.
Right. One of the, like I said, one of our events that we are bringing to Polk County is the Super Bowl. And we've had the Super Bowl here probably for the last 4 to 5 years. Mm-hmm. It'll be at Bryant Stadium on November the 12th. Mm-hmm. That event, like I said, it will be right now we've just started our playoffs. The first round of the playoffs is this coming week. And we will... On the 12th, we'll have everyone that from each one of the districts from all around the state, you know, and their champions of those districts and of those regions will bring them here to Polk County. And again, it'll be 10 teams that have shown that they are the best as far as playing that game on the field. They've scored the most points and. You know, it'll be a great day. It'll start.
And so, do you whittle down from the 10 teams to the two, or?
Well, we actually whittle down from it'll be three teams in each district, which we have 8 districts. So the whittling down starts then. Okay. Once they get to the Super Bowl, we'll be down to 10 teams.
Okay, and that's what I mean. So when you're at the 10 teams there, are they? Do they?
Those are the final. We'll have final games. It'll be 5 from the east and 5 from the west.
Okay.
And they'll play each other and we'll crown a champion.
And you think about that. 10 teams and how that multiplies with people and fans and cheerleaters and the whole
because
thing.
Because we have probably football players about 7,000 in all, and maybe cheer off. I mean, as far as cheerleaders, we probably have another 5,000, and they're going to follow this. You know, they may not be in the in the Super Bowl game, but they're going to come to watch. Exactly, they want to come see who's the champion.
Well, James, we certainly appreciate it. And when we come back in our next segment, we're going to talk to Tracy, who's in charge of the cheerleading side, which is just as important, not only on the support and cheering side at games, but their competitions and the big economic impact here in Polk County. So, James, thank you so much. We appreciate you coming in. Good luck on your event on November 12th. And thank you for all that you do for Polk County.
All right. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, James.
All right. Well, before we bring Tracy on, we're going to look at the World Amateur Baseball Association. They put on a number of events right here in Polk County. Take a look at this footage. Hank and Neil will be right back with Tracy from the cheerleading side of things. Stick around, everybody.
It brings 23 junior college programs and 26 high school showcase teams together for one weekend. It's a great recruiting event for college coaches. Division I NAIA junior college this is a big event for them.
This is one of the best events of the year. Get to see a lot of junior college baseball players. In Florida historically has some of the best junior college baseball in the country. It's a well-run event, and just a chance to see some of the better players in the country all in one day.
Beautiful facilities here. Lakeland, the city of Lakeland, and the Detroit Tigers are such great partners, and this facility is pristine, second to none. But I think this is a great event for the county, the city, and all the participants.
It helps everybody. It helps us get quality players. It helps them move on to a four-year school, which a lot of these kids are trying to do. And it's a great event for us because we're right down the street. Just basically get to walk over here. We're a mile from our field.
Just about every organization is represented here, including the Scouting Bureau. And the college coaches in attendance are from FSU, LSU, Florida A&M, Barry, Florida Southern, imagine that. But just about every baseball power, college baseball power, is represented here.
Here at this event, fourth year coaching, we pull players from Florida junior colleges every year. Pretty much 70% of our roster consists of Florida junior college players.
Well, it's just exciting that the county, Polk County Sports Marketing, the city of Lakeland, and the people of this community support an event like this that helps players. This could be the future for someone. It could mean the difference in where they go to college, getting an education, or even being a professional player. So hats off to the community and all of our partners.
Neil Duncan alongside Hank Longo, and some great footage there from WABA, to use the acronym. Of course, Bing Tyus there highlighted in the footage, owner of that particular brand. And you know, you look at everything that Bing has done at Polk State College and all over Polk County, and well, that's the reason he's in the Polk County Sports Hall of Fame, which is located at the Lake Myrtle Sports Park.
Gotta come see it. Gotta come
see it. Tourism and sports marketing, yeah. Well, he put it together, so you know him and Mary.
Come on down. But,
it is a great facility. This third segment brought to us by the Holiday Inn in Winter Haven, another great facility here in Polk County. Yeah. So we were talking about the football.
And you know what goes with football?
What's that?
Cheerleading.
That's right. That's right. So we're going to welcome to the program Tracy Faison. She is the cheerleading coordinator for Mid Florida Football and Cheerleading Conference. And I believe you were on the program last year as well.
Yes,
were
I was.
You?
Well, yes,
we
thank you.
You didn't get scared, so you came back. So that's a positive sign, right?
Yes.
Well,
Hank's a very scary guy.
She heard I was going to be here on the show and knew she
boy.
Couldn't miss fun opportunity. So I mean,
well, before we talk about the event itself, obviously you guys are part of the Super Bowl and the contest and all that. But I want to ask, how have you seen it change over the years between, 100 years ago when I was in high school, mm-hmm. where the cheerleaders were at the games, they cheered, and that was about it.
Mm-hmm.
There were some competitions, but depending on where you lived and all that, but competition cheerleading has really become a major sport, not only in the States, but in the state of Florida. How have you seen that change?
Yes, I've seen that change, like you mentioned, that in the past, it was just sideline cheering, mm-hmm. and that was it. That was the only time that the young ladies had the time to show their skills. Mm-hmm. Now, they have showing their skills on the sidelines and also competition. Mm-hmm. So that means that it's very competitive now. And we do have a lot of kids that are in our community that put themselves in the gym, you know, so they can shine on the seasons at the competitions.
Now, when you've gone from just being on the sidelines cheering to competition, this thing has grown into a huge event for cheerleaders. Mm-hmm. And do they, I guess there's teams that compete, and then you have cheerleaders that are cheerleading at the games. Mm-hmm. So are there cheerleading teams that just compete and don't cheer at games, or do they do both?
Okay, the structure of Mid-Florida Football and Cheerleading Conference, they do both.
Okay.
So that means they have to be well-rounded, because they have to get their cheers that they're gonna do on the sidelines, and then they also have to think about what they're gonna do at the end of the season for their big day. So they do both.
It's funny, it reminds me of when I played high school football. And of course, you know, when you're in high school, you have an inflated perception of how good you really are. So I'm sure I had that going on. But I had this conversation with some of the cheerleaders, and you know, we thought we were the most important part of a football game, and they were telling us, it's not all about you guys. And so we were having a conversation back and forth. And the best thing I've ever heard was a comeback, and she said, you guys might make plays, but we're the ones that keep the crowd up when you're letting them down.
Well, yeah.
I was like, you know what? You win. You win. But talk about that. What is the main focus? Obviously, sports and competition, it's been well documented over the years, getting kids, getting youth involved in activities. What is the focus for Mid-Florida on the cheerleading side of, you know, the positive, being positive and role models and all that? What do you guys do to incorporate that? Mm-hmm.
Our focus is as well as the skilled. We want to introduce, to let the kids know that you can have, it's more skilled out there. Mm-hmm. You also, because a lot of kids in the community don't know that you can also get a scholarship in college, mm-hmm. as cheering. Mm-hmm. So we try to put that competitive, once they understand that, and also put the competitive part in, and also put the life skills. As we know, cheerleading do not go to the NFL, but it can earn you a nice living, mm-hmm. By getting that scholarship and going to college and coming back to our community and living well and giving back to the community.
You know, a lot of people don't, or I shouldn't say a lot of people don't, but I think it's one of these things where if you can go to school on a scholarship these days, and if it's a full ride or if it's a partial ride, with college costing anywhere from maybe $15,000 to $30,000 a year or up, mm-hmm. you know, depending on the school, that's a heck of a nice bonus.
Absolutely.
You know, it really is. And to be able to enjoy something and get good at it and then have that enable you to get an education, that's really a wonderful thing.
Do you feel like FHSAA, when they finally, I don't want to say finally, but when they adopted cheering as an officially sanctioned sport for state championships, and you know, I know there's a lot of great cheer schools here in Polk County. Mm-hmm. I'm a Bartow guy, so obviously I know about Bartow, mm-hmm. winning multiple
Absolutely.
National championships,
yes.
as well as state championships. How did that help the sport? How is it helping it grow? Because as you said, it also brings light to the fact that scholarships are available. But how did that, it's almost like finally being recognized for what you guys knew all along,
Absolutely.
That it is skills and it is a sport.
Well, it helped the community know and had them look at it as a sport, which from that part for us, instead of going out and just saying we're just going to go and do sideline cheering, and that it wasn't, we were just out there. Now the kids, the parents see it as a sport, just as football, soccer, baseball, or any other sport.
Well, you have cheer people. Kids that participate in this that start pretty young.
Yes.
What is your first age group with cheering?
rearrange, we mirror the football division. So flag start from 4 to 6, and they cheer for the 4 to 6 4 to 6 boys.
That's got
to
be precious. It has to be.
They are darling. They are. And then 7 to 8, 9 to 10, 11 to 12, and then 13 to 15. So wow. Each one of those division girls cheer for the same division of boys.
And how often do they practice?
They have a total of 8 hours they can practice in a week. And they can divide that up of however that league chooses.
That's
but it's
quite
only
a bit
have
of
to be
hours
eight
a
hours a week. Yes.
You know, yeah. If you add it up, if you're 5 days a week, it's over an hour a day, which, you know, is time consuming. Very much so.
I forgot to ask in our last segment, but I'm assuming they have to adhere to certain GPAs, grade checks, things
Absolutely.
Like that.
Absolutely.
Which the good thing, it seems not only football, but it seems like all sports have gone to, you know, even though it's not a school sanctioned event, they're making sure that you have to get your grades, which is obviously important. October 22nd, the Mid-Florida Football and Cheer Conference Cheer Off.
Yes.
What is, let's talk about exactly what a cheer off is and how is that different from the event on the 13th, which is the certification regional competition.
Okay. On October the 22nd, the Mid-Florida Football and Cheerleading Cheer Off is only for the teams that are in Mid-Florida. So we'll have 1,400 girls be at Bronze Stadium.
Oh my
gosh. So we'll have 223 teams will be participating that day, starting at 8 o'clock and whenever we finish.
Wow.
Typically, how long does that take?
We get out about 11.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
And so, do they compete more than one at a time? I would think they would have to with that many teams.
Actually, we have gotten it to a science
where
they only compete one at a time, but we have two panel of judges. So we're moving. So one team will start with the 4 to 6. Every 4 to 6 team that's in the conference will line up, and they're the first A panel. They'll come out, then another team, B panel, a judge, so, and it'll just continue on like that all day.
Now, how long do they cheer for?
They cheer for 2.5 minutes.
Okay.
And that includes a cheer, a chant, and a dance.
A cheer, a chant, and a dance. Go, yay. Kind of like that, and there goes all my equipment. I just got knocked off TV, but hey.
It's the best thing
learning.
I've seen today.
Yeah.
I don't even know where to go after that. How can someone get involved with the Mid-Florida Football Conference or Football and Cheer Conference?
Yes, our website, which has all of the team's information, is midfloridafcc.com.
Okay.
So wherever the graphics region where they are, they can locate teams there with their information.
All right, and after this event, is there a national event? Is the affiliation with?
Yes, after the conference event, then we have NYCC regionals. So that one is all the teams that finish at the top. They go over to the regionals that will be November the 13th that we also will have at Bryant Stadium. And that includes other conferences that we bring into that we compete against.
Wow.
So we try to find out who has the best cheerleaders in each conference.
All right. Well, October 22nd, Bryant Stadium, correct?
Yes.
All day long, sounds like.
All day long.
Did you say 9 a.m.?
First, 8 o'clock.
8 a.m. 8 a.m. Bryant Stadium.
So yeah, bright and early for this thing all day long.
Yes.
And if you haven't been at that event, it is a fantastic event. Again, as we continue to talk about that economic impact and folks coming into our community, this is a perfect example of that. And we certainly appreciate all your efforts, Tracy, and look forward to having you again next year to talk about the event as I'm sure it grows bigger and better.
Yes, thank you.
All right. Well, recently we had the chance, our PGTV crew, to catch up with a young individual named Brendan, who was formerly at Lake Wales and now currently a freshman at University of Central Florida. He's a bowler. Check out this information. Hank and Neil will be back right after this.
bowled in Los Angeles. I bowled in the Little League. I had to be four. A couple years before I moved to Florida, and I bowled in the league. My family had been bowling. My parents met in a bowling alley, so I was just kind of there for daycare, essentially. I've played a lot of different sports. I played baseball for 9 years. I played football my eighth and ninth grade year and part of sophomore year. I also picked up tennis right around the same time I started bowling, and I still do them both alongside each other to this day. Bowling will knock you down, and sounds ironic because it's a sport about knocking down, but it'll knock you down emotionally, physically, mentally, and you have to find a way to get through it, because there are 10 frames in a game, and I can go out, miss two spares, and if I strike out the rest, I'm still sitting pretty at the top of any leaderboard I'm on. I've definitely developed a bit of a temper, because it's so easy, especially when you're a perfectionist with athletics like myself, it's so easy to get frustrated, but out of that temper that I've built, I've also built a work ethic within myself, a mental edge that you don't see in a lot of other sports. They always say that the greats have the mental edge, and coming out here and missing 310 pins in a row, getting knocked down constantly, it's a battle of up and down. And once you get used to that, you feel like you can conquer anything mentally. And that's always been really rewarding, and it shows in schoolwork, it shows in social situations. You grow a lot through adversity in sports. The hardest things for me was always trying to keep in mind that bowling isn't completely individually based. That was always so difficult for me, and I don't know why, but you go to a lot of these tournaments and they're singles tournaments, but you come to the high school and it's a team. So now you have a whole different world. Not only am I bowling for myself, but I'm bowling for four other guys or five other guys, how many we have. The biggest misconception is definitely the athleticism behind it, because it's like golf. It doesn't really look athletic, but it's not about the exertion. It's about the technique. You don't really have to be in tip-top shape. You don't have to be in football shape or anything like that. I mean, Wes Mallott, professional bowler, he does not have the body of an athlete at all, but he's one of the best guys on tour because of his mechanics. Deep knee bends, keeping your arms straight, ball in line with your head, all of the modern game techniques, and he does them perfectly. And that's another aspect of bowling that you always have to keep in mind. You watch TV today, they always have a bowling episode. I don't know why, but they have a bowling episode and they're eating nachos, they're drinking beer. And I mean, that happens, but you're still bowling at the end of the day. And I'm not eating nachos at a tournament. And if so, I'm eating them with my left hand. And that's always been like, do you eat while you bowl in tournaments? No, I don't. I'm going to the University of Central Florida. Definitely be bowling for the team up there. They don't give scholarship money, but you can still bowl for the team anyways. And if bowling's something that I'm going to enjoy for the rest of my life, then that's what I'm gonna end up doing.
Welcome back to the fourth and final segment of Sports Central, brought to you by Spectra, of course, the great partner
Thank
there
you.
At the Lakeland
yep.
Center.
They very much are. Delighted to have them be a part of our show.
Bowling. Do you do a lot of bowling?
No.
No?
No. I mean, I have fun bowling. I just don't go out and bowl a lot, do you?
No, I don't. I enjoy it, but I guess I just don't do it.
When you watch someone like that bowl, you start to see how technique and style really plays a big part.
I don't think he uses the bumpers like I do. And not just to keep it out of the gutter. I mean, it's like a, well, whatever.
Whatever.
Again, fourth and final segment, Sports Central, brought to you by Spectra. We do appreciate them. We've got some events coming up.
We've got all kinds of events coming up, and that's what keeps things rolling here in Polk County. Thursday, October 13th through Saturday, October 15th, is the Florida State Golf Association's 9th Annual Stroke Play Championships, the Mid-Amateur Stroke Play Championships. So,
you going to compete in that?
No.
I wish I could. A lot of people to count if you and I went out there.
I wish I could compete in that, but.
A clicker.
Yeah. That's how I keep score, with an attendance clicker. Okay, I'm around 15 now.
You can email Jeff at fsga.org for more information on this. Again, it's Thursday, October 13th through October 15th, the Lake Mirror Auto Classic coming up.
What a great event that is. If you've never been to the Lake Mirror Auto Festival, even if you're just not a big fan of cars, you will be once you go to this event, because mm-hmm. they just have cars all over, and exotic cars, very expensive cars, unique cars, one of a type,
right.
type of vehicle. So it's a really neat event to go to, and what a beautiful way to spend a fall afternoon.
Of course, it's this weekend, the 14th, 15th, and 16th. If you're watching us live, you can go for more information to LakeMirrorClassic.com. It truly is
over
a fantastic
600
event.
Cars.
Yeah, and it's one. It's an example. I know Mark Jackson likes to talk about this, but it's an example of one of those events that was homegrown and turned into a huge, huge event for Polk County and all those folks coming in from all over the country. Great, great event.
Yeah.
Frank Tiano Enterprises, of course, Frank Tiano does a great job of bringing events to Polk County. His 12 o'clock high, that's Thursday, October 20th through the 23rd. Of course, that's at Paradise Field in Lakeland, Gate 36. So if you're going out there to Paradise Field, it's Gate 36. Event details, go to franktiano.com.
And these are radio RC, you know, radio controlled mm-hmm. aircraft. And they go from the little aircraft to big jets. I mean, some of these planes cost like $20,000. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're unbelievable. And when you see them flying in the air, you actually think it could be a military jet, or it's amazing.
Would you have the nerve to be able to basically take your car and be able to fly it around with a remote control and watch it go over the into the distance or into the woods or something?
Well, I think before you're flying your car over into the woods, you have a little airplane that you're learning on and you gradually work your way up. But
it's a huge investment.
It is a huge investment.
I'm sure they're insured.
And so, well, yeah, it's a very good question there. Yeah. Well, another fun event coming October 21st through the 23rd is the Lightning City Gymnastics annual Gasparilla Invitational, and it's mm-hmm. girls from ages 4 to 17 from across the state of Florida, which will be competing.
Yeah. LightningCity.com for more information on that event or other events that they put on. We already talked about it on this show, the Mid-Florida Football and Cheerleading Cheer-Off, Saturday, October 22nd at Bryant Stadium.
You know, I was amazed by the number of kids that they're coming into town that participate in this.
That's huge.
It's unbelievable.
Which is good, because,
is,
you know, I alluded to it and commented about it earlier. Keep these kids involved in something, because if they're involved in something, they won't get into anything.
And they're giving them also good life lessons, which is very important.
Absolutely. Fall baseball. High school baseball.
And we
is
talked
in the
about that. Yeah, we talked about that a bit. Is, you know, hey, what's going on with fall baseball? Well, it's just these guys continuing to play baseball.
It's like any other sport. It's year round. A lot of athletes, by the time they get to high school, a number of them anyway, start specializing mm-hmm. in one sport. So it's year round training. And Lake Region High School is very good at putting on events, and they're going to put on the Lake Region Fall Classic. That is the 22nd through the 23rd. That's actually at the Channel Lakes Complex in Auburndale. This is U18 and U16. If you want more information on this event, contact Coach Bullock at wbullock7@tampabayrr.com. And again, that is the Lake Region High School Fall Classic.
a big event for the Florida Youth Soccer Association, the Florida State Premier League. And that's, boy, all kinds of stuff going on in the next few weekends, the 22nd through the 23rd of October. But this is a premier event for these soccer players.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, you look at the events that the Florida Youth Soccer Association brings in, these events don't just show up. It was part of recruiting the Florida Youth Soccer Association, the county tourism and sports marketing, the city of Auburndale, bringing those organizations here, and then they have to host, you know, 20 plus events a year here as part of their contractual agreement. It's a 50-year agreement for them to be in Polk County. So, you know, sometimes we move on to the next big thing that is recruited to Polk County, but we need to pause and talk about some of the successes. And this is a perfect example of a success in Polk County, bringing in the business long term, not just a one and done type of event.
Well, and if you're familiar where we are at Lake Myrtle Sport Complex in Auburndale, as you go down Berkeley Road to 92, that whole area is developing to accommodate all the events. So this is going to be a neat event for the soccer players, because they're going to be competing against teams from all over the state of Florida. So they're going to get to see how they match up against these other players.
I know we're starting to run a little bit short on time, but we want to talk about again, we showed a video earlier in the show, the 2016 Florida Harley-Davidson Owners Group, the Hog Rally, the acronym, the Hog Rally. That is coming to Polk County October 25th through the 29th. They're talking hundreds and hundreds of riders coming in. These are business people and people that enjoy the Harley-Davidson experience.
Hobby.
It's their hobby, bringing in that economic impact. They're going to be event locations at the Hilton Garden Inn, Centiphone Complex, going to be all over Polk County doing their rides, going to the restaurants, going to our establishments, really bringing in those dollars, dropping them off during the event.
You know, they've got a vendor expo, they've got riding expeditions and games, and just a really big spectacle of an event for these fellows in their Harleys.
Absolutely. So we're excited that is coming. South Tampa Athletics Incorporated bringing in the Gulf Coast Cheer Classic. We talked about the Mid-Florida. This is one of those specialty events coming in. The Lakeland Center, I know we've talked to their staff. They could have a cheer competition every weekend of the year if they wanted to. And we're okay with that, because great economic impact for Polk County.
And a friend of mine has girls that are cheering. He says it's just constant. They're going from one place to another.
Yeah. So that event's
keeping them awful busy.
Yeah, that's going to be the 29th and the 30th again. That's at the Lakeland Center. So if you want more information, just reach out to the Lakeland Center folks or go to lakelandcenter.com.
And then Frank Tiano having another big event, the Red Flag RC airplane event coming up in November, the 1st through November 5th. And
aerobatic competition.
That ought to be pretty exciting.
Yeah.
And then we're going to wrap it up. We've got just a few more seconds, but also on November 9th, the board presents the Grind for Life series of Lakeland, and it's the sixth stop for the Grind of Life series. It's skateboarding of all ages. Contest takes part in various parks throughout the state of Florida, so that ought to be a really neat event to go to. If you're into skateboarding, we got it all going on.
Got some sponsors we want to thank.
We do have some great sponsors and couldn't be here without them. Thank you so much for your support. Hampton's Inn Lakeside Village, Harry Seafood Bar and Grill, Hollywood Signs, Sunsplash Vacation Homes, and the Trophy Shop. Thank you all so very much.
Yeah, we'd like to thank our sponsors. We'd like to remind you, go to centralfloridasports.com or visit centralflorida.org for a full listing of events. This is just a snapshot of the things going on here in Polk County. Central Florida Sports, visit Central Florida. We also want to tell you about the radio version of Sports Central on Talk 1430 WLKF and Talk 96.7. The next show, live show of Sports Central on TV, will be Friday, October 28th. Until then, for Hank Longo, I'm Neil Duncan, and we will see you next time.
Bye-bye.